What's up, Mushroom Fam? It's Gary with Fresh from the Farm Fungi. I'm here at 7,500 feet on this beautiful December day in Sedalia, Colorado. Today's video is going to be about why you should never put spores onto grain. I've been getting a lot of questions lately about some agar work and, you know, the pros and cons of using agar. Why can't you just skip agar and go directly onto grain? So you can do that if you use a liquid culture, which is different from a spore syringe. So if you want to check out my video on the differences between a liquid culture and a spore syringe, I'll post a link there, or I could put a little card in the top here. So check out that video to clear up a lot of questions. And then I'll go through some of, you know, the problems from going straight from spore to grain. But before I get into that, I just wanted to update you guys on what's been going on here. So last Friday, we had our Quonset building delivered here in Sedalia. So I just wanted to say thank you to everyone who came out. I did not expect such a good turnout, so it really means a lot. Everyone showed up, and especially the truck driver who ended up backing a 70-foot semi truck all the way from Highway 67, which is almost a mile down this hill here. So he reversed it all the way up to the building site. Huge shout out to Steelmaster for hiring that truck driver. He was, you know, a godsend for us. I also want to give a shout out to Chris at Colorado Fresh Market. He's the market manager, and he came out to support us, as well as Rich from Airy Bros Radio. So check out Airy Bros. We did a podcast with Rich a couple months ago, and I know his brother couldn't make it, but I appreciate you for coming out here. Also, Zach from Mushroom Cult Pro. So Zach and I, we actually finished teaching our last in-person class for the year. It went really well, so that was an awesome experience. Thank everyone for coming out. We had a couple people from Seattle fly in, someone from Rhode Island, so it's definitely gaining some traction. I highly recommend coming if you can make it out for a weekend. There's lots of activities to do in Denver, and our classes are just getting better and better every single time. So mushroomcult.net/events. Our next class is scheduled for January 15th, and it's going to be an online tutorial. So we did one of those a couple years ago for the Denver Botanical Gardens, and since then we've really dialed it in, and we're going to be doing a lot more footage of like first person view, or just really explaining the procedures in a 4-hour class. So if you can't make it out to the in-person one, we are going to be offering that online tutorial January 15th from 9 a.m. till noon Mountain Time. So that is also available on mushroomcult.net/events. So big thank you for everyone else who I didn't mention here. I know you took a few hours out of your Friday to come help unload 7,000 pounds of steel. So I really thank you guys, and I appreciate all of that. So going into year 4 with the new building, it's going to take some time to get this set up. So unfortunately, the temperatures are kind of coming to that point where I don't think we'll be able to pour the slab until spring. But I'm looking for someone who could help us excavate. I know I talked to my friend Paxton out there, and if you can fit it into the schedule, let me know. But other than that, we're just holding out for the weather to warm up before we can pour the slab. And then it will be the next phase into that building project, which I'm super excited for. I still can't even believe that we got that onto our property now, and it's just baby steps forward. And now the next step is just continuing building and just being really thoughtful for the planning process. I'll go through that as we build out our grow. But for today, I wanted to just talk about some problems that could arise if you skip agar and go straight from spore into grain. So I'll start off with a question. So what grain has the most inoculation points per gram? Is it A, popcorn, B, wheat, C, oats, or D, millet? So I'll explain that a little bit further. Just keep that in mind. So what grain has the most inoculation points per gram? Going from spore to grain, some of the problems that could arise. The most obvious problem is going to be contamination. So one of the powerful aspects of using agar is that it's going to separate out those spores and allow you to observe if there's any contaminants that are present. So if you go straight into a grain jar, there's a high chance that inside that three-dimensional vessel, there's going to be contamination that forms. And then you're going to break up that grain jar, inoculate it into your bulk substrate, and then the chances are high that you'll carry that contamination into your bulk procedure, and it's going to be a waste of time. The way around that will be to take your spores, plate them out onto agar, and then select for a clean, healthy mycelium. So I did make a video on mycelium morphology if you want to look at that. Otherwise, I'm going to be doing my breeding project and really breaking down how to select for healthy mycelium. But you definitely don't want to skip this phase, because going onto agar is going to help select for more rigorous growth. So the number one problem we just covered, contamination that could be hidden in the spores. So that just happens because spore prints are pretty dirty by nature. When you take your spore print, it's coming from a mushroom that has been exposed to the environment, unless you're doing it aseptically, like for cordyceps, or if you grow in vitro inside of a bag or inside of a tub, then the chances are highly likely that your spore print is going to have some kind of bacteria or mold that came from the environment. So you can mitigate those by doing a serial dilution. I've explained that in the past. But without adding those extra steps, then you're going to have contamination problems. So the next problem, or issue, I should say, about going from spore into grain is going to be the multiple phenotypes that are going to be battling out inside that grain jar or bag. So when you inoculate a bunch of different spores into a substrate, they're going to germinate. They're going to find competitive or compatible mates, I should say, and then they're going to compete against all those other spores that are germinating. So from a cultivator perspective, you are leaving it up to those spores to compete against that same volume and same mass of nutrients. So that is not very efficient. And on top of that, it's not going to produce good results. You can go through like a PF tech or a brown rice flour tech, find the strong mushroom, and then clone that and use that. That will be a good method. But to just inoculate a bunch of spores into grain, they're all going to compete against each other. There's going to be a lot of division within that container. And then when you go into a bulk substrate, you're going to have many different phenotypes. So maybe that first flush will just be from one phenotype that flushes earlier, and instead of maximizing the volume and effort in that bag, you're only going to get a small fraction of that phenotype fruiting. So if you want really nice flushes, if you want, you know, consistent yields, you're going to have to go from a liquid culture or an isolated petri dish culture, so that you won't have that problem of competition inside your fruiting chamber. So I guess the third issue would be the variability of those results. So if you're going to be farming mushrooms commercially, or if you just want, you know, a guaranteed output, then you're going to have to isolate that phenotype or that clone, genetic copy of the specific mycelium. So if you're going with spores, it could be similar. It could be, you know, almost identical to that mother strain that you took the spores from, but the chances are that you'll have a bell curve of phenotypes. So your results won't be consistent. You'll have many different phenotypes competing, and you'll have a high risk for contamination. So those are the three main reasons that you don't want to go from spore to grain. So I have seen it work. I've done similar experiments just by using PF tech, but you don't want to really scale up with spores. I hope that makes sense. I hope that answered your question for whoever reached out. And if you ever have any more questions, feel free to email freshfromthefarmfungi@gmail.com. Give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed this video. Stay tuned for more mycology videos like these. Please subscribe. It really helps the YouTube algorithm, and we're trying to grow this channel to spread as much mycelium as possible. If you have any questions that you're confused about, comment below. So, going back to the question at the beginning of the video, what grain spawn has the most inoculation points per gram? Is it A, popcorn, B, wheat, C, oats, or D, millet? So the answer is going to be D, millet. Approximately 150 inoculation points per gram compared to popcorn, which might be only 3 or 4. So the way that you should think about grain spawn, instead of being a nutritious substrate, it should be used as a vehicle for spreading the mycelium. So the smaller the grain per gram, the more inoculation points, the more surface area that that mycelium has to develop on its final bulk substrate. So I hope that makes sense to you guys. I might do a follow-up video explaining grain in more detail, but I hope that cleared up why you shouldn't go from spore to grain. All right, guys, give us a thumbs up, and until next time, much love.